Michael Mason, you were news editor at Gay News in the 1970s from 1972. Can you tell me, before Gay News, what the attitude of the mainstream press was in covering gay-related stories?
Well, they were a little selective about the stories they covered. What they used to cover was magistrates' court hearings. I mean, a gay story was about a teacher or a scoutmaster who got into trouble. I mean, there wasn't any other news, really, unless there was a big government scandal. Even then, it tended to be some criminal offence. You know, when Ian Harvey got caught in St James's Park with the guardsman. That was it. It was crime. Liberace libel scandal.
And before you joined Gay News as news editor, you were involved in the Gay Liberation Front. Mm-hmm. Can you tell us a few of your memories about the GLF?
Well, it was a complete shock for me. I was brought up to be a Tory and an establishment creature. And then the Gay Liberation Front happened with its revolutionary roots in to do with feminism and black power movement in the States. And it completely changed my political outlook on life. Completely changed all my social relationships. I very quickly was involved in Gay Liberation Front activity 7 nights a week, quite literally, in the theatre group or the manifesto group or the steering committee. Or completely took over my whole life.
And did the GLF, did it partly lead to the formation of Gay News?
Yes, though I don't know how, because I didn't know about the formation of Gay News. It was something that went... Gay Liberation Front really only existed for about 18 months in its full flourishing state. And then it dissolved and fragmented and went different ways. And one of the fragments was Gay News. And I wasn't involved in those early talks about setting it up. But it came out of GLF.
Had you been involved in journalism yourself?
No, I hadn't. Though my father was on Fleet Street and was a publisher, later a publisher. So I knew about journalism. I'd been to the Children's Press Club party, but no, I hadn't been involved in journalism. And computers.
And you joined Gay News a couple of months, about 3 months after it had been launched. How did you get involved?
Well, I dropped out with GLF, and I was doing a paraffin round once a week and living on the dole, because this was the romantic hippie dropout thing to do. And I took about 6 months of it, climbed the wall. My partner realised that I couldn't take it anymore, and he spotted an ad in Gay News for business manager and said, why don't you apply for that, because you clearly want to do something. And I thought, well, I can do that in my sleep. But if I get the job, what I wanted to do was to get onto the editorial side. So I applied for the business manager job, got it, even though there was opposition, because I came from a public school in Oxford, and that counted against me joining games. So I got the business manager's job, and then 6 months later I was a news editor. So...
And what were your memories of those early days?
Well, it was excitement. I mean, the idea of there being a gay newspaper was astonishing. It was the business manager side of it. I remember very little about it. It was to do with keeping it. It was bookkeeping and looking after subscriptions and things like that. But what was going on the editorial side was just fascinating. It was bringing people from all strange corners of the kingdom together.
I mean, you came from a private school background, an Oxbridge background. I mean, I know there were people there who'd never been to university.
Yeah.
It was a real melting pot.
Sure.
And did everybody get on?
Oh, no. I mean, at one level, yes, because we were all part of a gang. You know, there was a bigger enemy outside, and you know, any state wants to have an outside enemy to coalesce its own citizens. And the same thing happened in the gay movement as well. Everybody was so passionate about this new revolutionary movement, as it felt, that everybody had strong beliefs. And they clashed. But there was an outside enemy. So
were you united by a common enemy then?
Yeah.
And your editor, well, one of the founders was Denis Lemon. Yeah. What was he like to work with? What are your own memories and perceptions of him?
Denis was driven and fierce. And what I wanted to do was to carve out the news section as a separate little principality, so that I could get on and do the news section without Denis being too much involved. And so I worked very hard to prove that the news section could make a go of it, could produce something really rather good, so that Denis wouldn't want to get involved, would be happy to let me get on with it, which he largely did.
So he gave you a lot of autonomy.
Well, there was an initial battle. When we started, we were following in the footsteps of the underground press, Friends IT. This was the great revolution of web offset printing, when suddenly the costs of entry into newspaper publishing fell hugely. Everybody started up. Gay News was part of that. And when we first came out, it was a slightly hippie-ish alternative press look to it. And my ambition as news editor was to have a news front page with headlines and a news report. Everybody loves news. I'm passionate about news. You know, we have nightly news programmes on TV that get huge audiences. That's what I wanted to concentrate on, was people's passion for news, and therefore I wanted the front page to be news, not features.
And while you were there, you must have covered quite a few news stories. What were the most challenging, do you remember?
The most challenging news story was Jeremy Thorpe's trial, the scandal around Jeremy Thorpe. That was only challenging because we had a 7 or 8 day deadline. It was 7 or 8 days before what we wrote got out onto the streets in print. And of course, Fleet Street was coming up with news stories every day, so we were always behind. We didn't have a lot to say. They were saying, what a nasty, perverted, kinky man he was. And we were saying, well, he's gay. And yet he's doing odd things, and there are strange guns and dogs and odd people in the background. We didn't know what to make of it. In news terms, how do you report the fact that it's a scandal, he's gay? Very difficult for a newspaper.
So you would have been going to news events. Obviously, when you were going to these events, it would have been the mainstream press as well. What was their relationship like?
Well, actually, the news we were covering were gay stories. Mm. And as I said, the mainstream press in those days was only interested in court cases. We were interested in groups forming within trade unions. Mm. We were interested in a group that wanted to get gay newspapers into their public library. Things that the straight press didn't see as news, weren't covering. So we went in competition with the straight press for news.
So was there any relationship with the mainstream press?
Well, slowly the GLF became a story, had become a story, and its aftermath, the idea of homosexuals demanding rights, and that sort of thing, slowly became a story. And Fleet Street had no way into that story, because we didn't have, the gay movement didn't have a press office in the Strand. There wasn't anybody that the Fleet Street could phone up except Gay News. We were the public face. They thought, oh, the journalists, they'll know what's going on. So they used to phone us. It was extraordinary being at the centre of so much that was going on then.
And when you were there, do you think that Gay News had a big influence on government policy? when it came to civil rights?
No. The big change happened in the 50s and 60s with Wolfenden and law reform, and then nothing happened until Section 28. I can't remember when the first change happened as far as the age of consent was concerned. I mean, the age of 16 came in under Tony Blair, and I can't remember when 18 happened. But it was long after, really after the gay news time. So no, I don't think we had any effect on central government policy. We had a lot of effect on local government policy.
And you would have been there during two major periods. The first was the obscenity case about two men kissing on the front cover, which Gay News was cleared of, but there was the big Mary Whitehouse case involving the James Kirkup poem. What are your memories of that?
It was unimportant and devastating. It was not an issue we wanted to stand on. It was a bad poem. and I didn't want it published, because it was sentimental. I was not a believer, and it was aimed at sentimental believers, gay believers, saying, the church is for you too. I didn't believe that. So I was angry that we got involved in having to fight that.
Had there been arguments about publishing it with Denis previously?
No, not really.
What was the atmosphere like then in the office?
Well, I'll
at the time?
Tell you what happened. I was up in the typesetting room with Richard Norton. Had an old IBM electric typewriter, composing machine. Denis came in with this poem and said to Richter, this will get the Christians going. Little did he know. That was the start of it. So that was the attitude, this will get the Christians going. And then it came out. There was a lot of fuss from our Christian readers who wrote to the letters page and said, you should not be publishing something like this. It's deeply offensive. So it was an argument over that from both sides. And then nothing. Came out in June. We then heard in something like October or November, a little piece in the Evening Standard, Mary Whitehouse was going to prosecute, take out a private prosecution. So it was all that time. We had no idea that there would be consequences.
Well, Denis Lemon and Gay News were both found guilty.
Yeah.
And there were appeals, but the appeals failed, although his suspended sentence was quashed. How did it affect Gay News as a publication and as a business?
Well, it took a huge amount of our time. I remember travelling all around the country, talking to groups, and we were fundraising for legal costs. People wanted to talk to us because it was a matter of public controversy. Denis was... It exhausted Denis. He was so much in demand and had so many calls on his time. He didn't have time to sleep, let alone edit a newspaper. So it was a big drain on everybody. It was tiny little, I mean, where there were 15 of us, something like that. And this thing lasted for 2 years.
Do you think it was the beginning of the end? Although, of course, it was a few years before Gay News folded. Do you think it led to
Finished
it?
Finished Denis.
Yes.
And Denis was an important part of the energies of Gay News, of its driving force. So, yes, I don't know too much about the ending. My friends were there, things were going badly wrong, and I didn't like to pry. I accepted what they said to me, but I didn't want to... You know, I was on capital gain by that time, and I didn't want to get too involved.
What do you miss most about Gay News?
Oh, friends. But equally, I miss the excitement of people finding themselves in finding whole new different ways of living. Once people had said to themselves, it's okay to be gay, They then started saying, why isn't my trade union defending me? Why isn't my church defending me? Why can't I buy a gay newspaper in my public library when I'm paying rates? All these different things started happening. And going around the country and seeing what people were up to was just enormous fun. Terribly exciting.
So you've talked about, perhaps it's part of its legacy, but it made people accept themselves more. It brought the community together. Any other greatest legacies?
It didn't. The gracious summing up of it all, and she often did this, sum up things. Alison Hennigan's remark that the gay news was the debating chamber of the web. So we provided a platform. We were absolutely, perfectly, clearly, dictionary definition, a medium. We were letting people talk to one another for the first time. There'd never been an arena for gay people to talk to one another.
So you helped be that debating chamber.
No, we were that debating chamber.
You were a uniting force.
That was a functional thing. But we were. It's like going into a restaurant, you have wonderful food. We were knives and forks in the place. You know, we were cutlery. But the food was coming from every corner of the country.
So that was one of its greatest achievements. What about its legacy? Would that play a role in it?
Legacy.
Is there a legacy?
It was a moment. It was a period in history. And history took its course. And there needed to be a gay news, something equivalent to that, to enable people to debate and to argue and to take things on. But whether you can call that gay news's legacy, I don't know. Yeah, I mean, I suppose we happen to be the one that did that function.
And a couple more questions about gay news. Are there any particular memories that you'd like to share in particular?
Oh, every morning was an excitement. I mean, personally, I just had a lot of thrills out of it. I mean, interviewing Tony Wedgwood Benn. I think he was still Wedgwood Benn. Might have been Tony Benn by then. And to have a senior politician say, well, good on you, fight for your rights, that was quite shattering. Going to a Bette Davis press conference and asking her why she had so many gay fans and shaking her hand. You know, these are personal things that live vividly. Leading the Gay Pride Parade in San Francisco, the 10th anniversary of Stonewall Pride Parade, my lover and I went there to cover it, and we were arrested by immigration. Such a fuss. Dianne Feinstein, then mayor, welcomed us at Grace Cathedral. We were invited to lead the Pride Parade.
Why were you stopped at immigration?
Because we were gay. Really? And in those days, it was illegal for homosexuals to enter the United States.
Gosh. So you've just talked about the animosity. No. You met Bette Davis, you met quite a few people. Was there any homophobia from any of the maybe celebrities or politicians that you went to interview?
Yes, but not people tended not to voice it to you. They would voice it to other people. I mean, I have a memory of Ian Paisley and his Save Ulster from Sodomy campaign. And I phoned him up at the House of Commons and asked to be put through. And they said, Mr. Paisley, it's not available. Leave your number, he'll phone you back. And I thought, yeah. And he did phone back. And I was absolutely shocked. And he was charming. I mean, he was quite outspokenly insistent on his belief that homosexuality is wicked, it's against the teachings of the Bible. But he was very cheerful and friendly and happy to talk about his beliefs and to accept that you differed. So I don't think many people had the courage to say what they thought to our faces, other than the odd one, like Paisley. And that was done in a very friendly fashion. Strange.
You left Gay News, would it have been around 1981?
Yeah.
and you went on to set up Capital Gay. Now, obviously you weren't at Gay News when it folded, but do you have any perception of what went wrong? What led to it?
I heard so many different versions. I think Andrew and Gillian's book, and Gillian Hanscom and Andrew Lumsden's book, gave me what I wanted to know. And
title fight.
The title fight.
The Battle for Gay News.
But exactly the machinations that went on with Denis Lemon and Robert Palmer, I really don't know about those. They were so opaque to me.
And why did you and your former colleague Graham McKerrow from Gay News set up Capital Gay?
I left Gay News to write a biography. My successor didn't work out, so I went back again. By which time Graham had joined as reporter. And we saw eye to eye on so much about the news, Gay News. And we had so many frustrations. And we used to go out at lunch, go out at lunchtime together and talk about them, and get them out of our systems. One of the things I've said earlier about this problem with the extended deadlines, about how it took 7 days to get something into print, that was hugely frustrating. We were very much London-based. We didn't have budgets to cover the country, and yet we purported to be a national newspaper. That was a frustration. And as we talked about these frustrations, we devised an ideal newspaper. It would be local. It would be it would be instant. It would be very quickly produced. We thought we weren't doing a good job. We thought that it would be ostensibly addressed to men, because we didn't have women involved. And one day, one of us said to the other, and we don't know who, said, "This is getting serious, isn't it?" And we suddenly realised that we devised a new type of paper.
When you got involved with Gay News, did you have a dream? And if so, has that dream come true?
I had lots of dreams. And most of them have come true. It was extraordinary. Once I got involved, a lot of my dreams were about doing news. And just, I wanted everybody to know what was going on. And we did that. We did it quite well. My thing about my ambition was to have news on the front page. You know, that was my big dream to begin with, and that happened. And yes, I mean, all sorts of things. I suppose my dream was that there should be equality, whatever that means. I was lucky. I mean, I've got this complete span of my life. I was born into a world where we were just criminals. And I'm now declining in retirement to an age where there's gay marriage. So that's one arc. The other arc was the technical side. I mean, we were born in an age where we just started the web offset. It was bringing a whole new type of newspaper into life. And we went through a bit where the foreign stories used to take 10 days to reach us because there wasn't fax. And then came the internet. I'm very glad I'm not involved in internet journalism. But there's another arc that's going on in the background, and I'm quite excited about that arc too. But yeah, a lot of my dreams have come true. A lot of the people I knew then, I still know, and they are happy. That's the best.
Final question. You wrote quite a few of the editorials for Gay News, and you didn't get a byline. Now, I know that...
I hated bylines.
But I know that truth, fairness and justice is very important to you, as is objectivity. Obviously, when you're writing an editorial, some of that can go out of the window. How did you square being objective with the news and then writing an opinion piece?
I don't think my editorials were so classy as to get beyond banalities about fairness and equality and whatever. And I'm very much aware of what I wrote. I think, I hope, reflected whatever everybody else's reaction. We all sat in a very small office and we talked and argued and whatever. And what went into the editorials largely came out of those discussions and the general feelings. And I think the only time I ever went entirely personal was my partner was called Carl Hill, and there is one editorial where the first letter of each paragraph spells C-A-R-L-H-I-L-L. And I think that was the most personal I ever got. That was our anniversary.
Thank you.